Belarus President Alexander Lukashenko says nations who are willing to join Russia and Belarus will be given nuclear weapons. This comes days after he confirmed the transfer of some tactical nuclear weapons from Moscow to Minsk had begun. Lukashenko, a close ally of Russian President Vladimir Putin, made the comments in an interview on a Russian media company. He also said it must be strategically understood that both the countries have a unique chance to unite, while also stating no one minds Kazakhstan and other countries having the same close relations that Belarus has had with the Russian Federation. His comments on handing out nuclear weapons to like-minded allies are likely to heighten concerns at a time of growing global proliferation. To the possible rise in concerns, Lukashenko said if someone is worried, then it is very simple. They just have to join in the union state of Belarus and Russia. That's all. And there will be nuclear weapons for everyone. But it is still not clear how wide Lukashenko's invitation to join the Union State extended, and he offered no other specifics. Although the Belarusian president was quick enough to say that it was on his own views and not that of the views of Russia, the proposal that he's making. Now, following his meeting with Russian President Vladimir Putin, Belarusian President Alexander Lukashenko mysteriously took critically ill. The cause of his decline of health is yet to be identified. Lukashenko's political rival has now pointed a finger at the Kremlin, alleging that the leader has been poisoned. Belarusian opposition leader Sepp Kalou, a former candidate for the presidency and a former ambassador to the United States, took to Twitter late on Sunday to level allegations against Moscow. He claims that the specialists attending to Lukashenko deem the leader to not be in a state to be transported back to his country. He further alleges that Moscow sent Lukashenko's private jet back to Minsk without him to mask his hospitalization. He says that Moscow has been aware of Lukashenko's deteriorating health for a while, and a political purge planned by Russia might be underway. Kuznick, he's joining us live from Washington, D.C. Peter, welcome back to WION, and thank you for joining us. Wow, things definitely escalated. What do you make of this announcement by Lukashenko and then the events that followed?
I think Lukashenko's saying that there will be nuclear weapons for everyone is a sign of madness. And this is the opposite of what the world wants and what the world needs. The last thing we need now is more nuclear weapons in more countries. The last thing we need is nuclear proliferation. The world is already poised at a precarious precipice with the threats that are going on. We see escalation on both sides. Just these overnight attacks in Kyiv, in Odessa, and other parts of Ukraine, right on the heels of the United States announcing that training will begin on the F-16s, that the U.S. will support that, plus the Storm Shadow missiles being sent by Britain. What we're seeing is a very dangerous escalation right now. The practical consequences of Russia putting these weapons in Belarus might not be that significant, but the symbolism of it shows that they are more and more concerned by what's happening and willing to be more aggressive. Lukashenko has said he doesn't speak for Putin when he talks about any country that wants these tactical nuclear weapons can get them. But keep in mind that the weapons in Belarus will be controlled not by Belarus, they'll be controlled by Moscow, in the same sense that the U.S. tactical nuclear weapons in Germany and Italy and Belgium and the Netherlands and Turkey are controlled by the United States. The risk of potential accidental problems is still great. We know that back in 2007, the United States accidentally flew a nuclear fighter jet cross-country with six nuclear weapons strapped to its wings without knowing it. So even if they're careful, there's no place for these kinds of weapons because the risk is too great.
And we've talked about this before, about the actions that the United States and NATO can possibly take at this point. You talk about perhaps reaching some kind of peace accord and a peace deal. It doesn't seem that Ukraine wants to do that unless Russia takes all its forces out of the country, including Crimea. Is that a viable aspiration and request?
No, no, no. That's an extreme position. The problem is both sides are making extreme positions, before they're willing to sit down and talk. So Russia's going for a military win. Ukraine is planning or hopes to drive all Russian forces out of Ukraine. No sober military analyst believes that is possible. To the Russians, Crimea probably is an existential threat. The possibility of the use of nuclear weapons and extreme tactics, Russia would probably go for a full-scale military mobilization, a full-scale state of war, if Crimea is threatened. So what we need is outside intervention. The Vatican is attempting to do so. Xi Jinping has been attempting to do so. Lula in Brazil has been attempting to do so. Six African states are saying we need to negotiate now. But what we see on both sides is they want to wait to see the outcome of Ukraine's spring counteroffensive. We don't even know when that's going to begin. Most military analysts do not think it's going to succeed in the way that Zelensky and Podolyak hope that it will. And so then we're going to be back where we are now, back at a stalemate, back at another meat grinder, hundreds of thousands more dead on both sides and injured, and then we're going to be sitting down to negotiate. I think we need a ceasefire now. We need to negotiate now, save lives, and figure out where to compromise.
Thank you so much for that analysis, Peter Kuznick from Washington, D.C. It's always great to talk to you. And
thank you.
We'll talk to you very soon.
Thank you.